Welcome back, friends. So far, we have completed the synchronization mechanism designing requirements. In this session, we are going to discuss the first synchronization mechanism, which is log variable solution. So, what are the properties or characteristics of this mechanism? The first one is, it is purely a software solution. Means, it does not have any dependency on hardware, that is CPU. So, no matter which hardware you are using, you can implement this mechanism in any language on any platform. The second characteristic is this mechanism is multi-process solution. Means if two or more, let's say 3, 4, 5, n number of processes wants to access a shared resource and I want to synchronize those n processes, you can use this mechanism. Why this point is mentioned? Because there are some other solutions, mechanisms such as the next one I am going to discuss is strict alternation, which is only useful to synchronize two processes. It cannot be used to synchronize more than two processes. But this solution can be used when there are more than two processes as well. The third one is called a user mode characteristic. The meaning is that this solution can be implemented at user level and you don't have any dependency on kernel mode, that is operating system level. In other words, you can implement this solution, you can simply write some program in C, C++ or Java or any other language that you use to design any software. You don't have to worry about how the kernel is going to execute your program, or you don't need additional privileges from the operating system. The fourth characteristic is busy waiting, that is spin lock. Means this mechanism uses the busy waiting concept, which is also known as the spin lock concept. I have explained this busy waiting and spin lock in my previous session. So it is nothing but checking some condition in a loop before the process enters in critical section. So let's look at the design of this log variable solution. So as per the synchronization mechanism common design, we have to design the entry section and we have to design the exit section for every process that is going to ask the critical section execution. Now, as per the design of this log variable, what we are going to do is take one simple integer variable declared in the entry section, which is shared among all the processes. And each process is going to check the value of this log variable. And the design is, when the log variable value is 0, it indicates that at this moment the critical section is available. Available means no other process has entered in critical section. Whereas if the value is 1, then it indicates that the critical section is busy. Someone is already passed the entry section and has entered into critical section. So in that case, the process have to wait. And once a process which is in critical section, once it completes the execution in critical section, in the exit section, it has to set the value of lock to again 0. Means it says that my execution is over. Now I am giving chance to some other process which is waiting in the entry section. So it releases the lock in the exit section, and that's how it comes out of the exit section and do its further non-critical section execution. Let me demonstrate this with the help of this sequence of processes execution. Let me initialize the value of lock variable to 0 as assumed. The first process arrives. Let's assume that the process P1 arrives and asks the entry section that can I enter into critical section. Now what process P1 will say? What is the current value of lock? It is 0. Means once it has checked the value of lock, which is 0, and 0 indicates that the critical section is free. So entry section says that, entry section code says that yes, you can go ahead in the critical section. And it makes the value of lock to 1. So process P1 has entered in critical section and it has made the value of lock from 0 to 1. It has changed the lock from 0 to 1. Now when the P1 is executing in CS, let's say the process P2 arrives and P2 again asks the question, can I enter into critical section? What the entry section will say? No, you cannot enter, you have to wait because someone has already entered in CS. And why it says so? Because the current value of lock is 1 and 1 indicates that some other process has already passed into the critical section. Now after some time, let's assume that the process P1 completes its execution and it comes below in the exit section. And in the exit section, it says that my execution of critical section is completed and now let me release the lock. So it has changed the value of lock to 0. Now the moment it has changed to 0, process P2 reads the value of lock 0 and it comes to know that someone has exited the critical section. So now P2 can enter in critical section. Now when P2 enters into critical section, it again changes the value of lock to 1 and then only it proceeds into critical section. Why we want to change the value of lock every time the process enters into CS? Because if some other process arrives, it has to know if someone is in the critical section or not. Let's look at the implementation of this solution now. So as I said, let me take the integer lock which is initialized to 0, shared variable, and let's take one other variable which is also shared, which is count variable. And here are the two processes P1 and P2 trying to modify or access the value of count. So I can mark these statements as critical section statements and other statements as non-critical section statements. So once the programmer identifies that here are my critical sections, now before the critical section we have to put the logic of the entry section. And what is the logic of the entry section? Here are the lines of code. So the first line here indicates that while lock is equal to 1, if the lock's value, current value, is equal to 1, means critical section is not free, someone is already entered in CS. So if this condition is true, we want to loop here, and that's why I have to put the semicolon in front of this while loop. When you put the semicolon in front of the while loop, it is nothing but just putting two curly braces opening and closing in for the while loop, and I'm not doing anything in the while loop block. I'm just checking the condition. Alright. So this is the busy waiting statement here. Till this condition remains true, it will keep on looping. The moment this condition is break, it will come in. So as of now, what is the current value of lock? Lock's current value is 0. So let's evaluate now. 0 is equal to 1. Condition is false. So this loop will break and the program counter or the control will come below. It will change the value of lock to 1 and then it will enter in the critical section. And as I said, in the exit section, we have to put the code which releases the lock, means which sets the value of lock to 0. Similarly, in each of the process which are trying to access their critical section, I have to put the entry section and exit section in the respective processes. So if you take n processes, in all n processes, you have to put the entry section followed by the critical section code and then followed by the exit section code. Let me demonstrate this execution with the help of a program counter. Let's assume that the process P1 starts the execution. The current value of lock is 0. So the condition is false and the program counter will come below. It will set the value of lock to 1 and it will proceed and enter into critical section. Now let's say that process P1 gets preempted and process P2 is scheduled. Process P1 is already in the critical section. While it is executing in the critical section, it is preempted and P2 is scheduled. So let me start the execution of P2. It will first read the value of lock. The current value of lock is 1. So this condition 1 is equal to 1 is going to be true and this loop will continue. Means it will again read the value of lock and again this condition is going to be true and so on. So up to which point this condition, this loop is going to execute till this condition become false. And the only way this condition become false is when this process P1 will come out of this critical section and sets the value of lock to 0. So let's preempt the process P2 for a while and schedule the process P1 again. So process P1 continues and it performs the exit section now. In the exit section, it is going to set the value of lock to 0. And it completes the exit section and it goes further and execute its some other code which is non-critical section code. Let's say after some time P2 is again scheduled to CPU and it will read the value of lock one more time. So at this moment, what is the value of lock? That is 0 and 0 is equal to 1. The condition is false and this loop is going to break here. And that's how the process P2 now can set the value of lock to 1. It is necessary. First, we have to lock the lock, I can say. And then it enters into critical section. And that's how we achieve the synchronization between two processes or more than two processes, you can say. Now, as per this design, we have to check the requirements of the synchronization mechanism are fulfilled or not. And what are the three requirements that we discuss? First one is the mutual exclusion, second one is the progress, and third one is the bounded waiting. In my previous session, I have explained the meaning or the how to check these three requirements for the given solution. So let's do for the lock variable one by one. Let us first talk about the mutual exclusion. So just to recap, how to check if mutual exclusion is guaranteed or not? We have to check if two processes can enter in CS simultaneously or not. If two or more processes are able to enter in CS simultaneously, then we say that the mutual exclusion is not guaranteed. Mutual exclusion is what? Only one process in the critical section at a time. So to prove this, let me take this program, again P1 and P2, and let's try to come up with a scenario if I am able to put the both the processes P1 and P2 in critical section simultaneously. So let me show you this execution of sequence Before that, you have to think from the assembly point of view. What is the assembly code corresponding to the entry section? That you have to always think in the synchronization mechanisms. Don't just execute this entry section at the higher level language, because CPU ultimately is going to execute not the higher level language, but the corresponding instructions of this higher level language. And these instructions are executed by CPU one by one. And you know that the preemption of process can happen after the execution of any instruction. So with that assumption, let's take the assembly code of this entry section. So here is the assembly code for while statement. What is the code? First read the value of lock into the register R1. The instruction is load. Let us take 34 is the address of this instruction. The second statement is comparison. Compare the value of register with the value 1. So here the 1, I have just mentioned it as #1. Actually, this will be the binary value for CPU. I am just showing it in a decimal way. So compare the value in the register R1 with the value 1. And then according to this comparison, this next statement works. The instruction is JNZ, stands for jump non-zero. In other words, non-zero means true, isn't it? Any non-zero value is considered as true by the CPU. Only zero value is considered as false. So what this comparison statement does, CMP, it compares these two values, R1 and 1, and it sets a flag within a CPU indicating that this instruction's outcome is either 0 or 1. In other words, I can say it is true or false. And according to the outcome of this comparison instruction, this next statement, that is JNZ, works. If the comparison is non-zero, means true. If the comparison is true, jump to instruction at the address 34. Alright. So JNZ takes an argument which is the address of any other instruction. So we know that if this condition is true, the while loop is going to loop one more time, and that's how, technically speaking, this JNZ instruction resets the program counter to 34. And that's how this loop repeats. Similarly, I have to consider the assembly code of this entry section of P2 also, similar assembly code, but let's assume that some addresses are different here. Let me start the execution and let's try to prove that mutual exclusion is guaranteed or not. So let me start the execution of P1 here. So here the first instruction is load the value of lock. What is the current value of lock? Which is 0. Load it in register R1. So the current value is loaded in register R1. Let us preempt this process and I give the chance to process P2 for execution. See, process may get preempted at any instruction. So I have just executed one instruction here and let's preempt that process. So I am scheduling the process P2, which also reads the value of lock, which is currently 0, in its register R1. Let's again preempt the process P2 and then give chance to process P1. So let me proceed with process P1 now. It compares the value in the register. What is the value? 0. And what value it wants to compare? 1. So 0 is equal to 1. The comparison is false. And that's why the next statement is not going to jump to this instruction. I am saying not going to jump because the previous comparison was false. That's why the program counter will proceed to the next instruction, that is 37, and it will reset, it will set the value of lock to 1. So here I have changed the value of lock to 1. And that's how the program counter enters into critical section. Now, while it is doing the execution in critical section, let's come back to the process P2. Let me continue the execution of P2. So, the next statement is compare. What is the value loaded in register? 0. 0 is equal to 1. Comparison is again false. And that's why this next instruction is not going to jump to the first instruction, that is 77. It is simply going to go ahead and change the value of lock to 1. So here is the value of lock again changed to 1. Even if it is currently 1, it is going to override the value of 1 with 1. And now it enters into critical section. So this sequence of execution proves that both the processes are able to enter in critical section. And that's why I say that the mutual exclusion is not guaranteed by the lock variable mechanism. So the first requirement itself is not guaranteed. So is the lock variable good synchronization mechanism? No. So the purpose of this learning this lock variable solution is to first learn how to prove that what are the problems in this simple solution which is executed at user level and with the just a while loop or some loop. Let's talk about the second requirement of synchronization mechanism, that is progress. And how to check the progress? Can any process that come first able to enter in CS? That we have to check. An assumption you have to make that is the only process which has arrived and no other process has arrived. Okay. So let me take the same two programs now, P1 and P2. Assume that both the processes are not arrived in the system as of now. So I have grayed out these processes. First, let's assume that the process P1 arrives. Initial value of lock is 0. So let's execute the entry section of process P1. So let me start the execution. It loads the value 0 into its register. It compares the 0 with 1. The condition is false. So next statement is not going to jump and the program counter will come below. It will change the value of lock to 1 and the program counter enters into critical section. That's how I say that process has entered in critical section if it comes first, process P1. Now we have to repeat this procedure for every process under assumption, assuming that other process is not arrived. So I will reset the system one more time. And assume that process P2 arrives first now. Take the original value of lock. Remember that we have to just assume that the process P2 has first arrived. So I'm just assuming that the system is reset and the P2 comes first and scheduled to CPU. So let's execute the process P2. It reads the value of lock in the register R1, which is 0. It compares the value of lock. The comparison is false. 0 is not equal to 1, by the way. And the next statement will not jump. The next statement is going to modify the value of lock to 1. And the process P2 enters into critical section. So here I can say when both the processes, when they come independently, are able to enter in CS first. That's why I say that the progress is guaranteed by the lock variable solution. Alright, let's look at the bounded waiting now. How to check the bounded waiting? The process which is already in the critical section, let's say I put a process in critical section. While it is in the critical section, some other process arrives and waits at the entry section. Now you have to check that the process which is in the critical section is able to re-enter into critical section or not. If it is able to re-enter into critical section, even if some other process is waiting, then we say that bounded waiting is not guaranteed. Alright. So here, let me explain with the help of execution of these two processes P1 and P2 concurrently now. So we have to come up with a sequence of execution with which I can say that a process can re-enter in CS or not. Alright, if some other process is waiting. So you have to bring both the processes concurrently and ask the question to one of the processes which is in critical section whether you are able to re-enter or not. So I am bringing both the processes here. So let's say the process, let's first put the process P1 in critical section and then only you have to ask the question to process P1. Remember in earlier session I gave you the analogy. One person enters in room and one person waits at the gate. Now the person in the room comes out of the room and asks the gatekeeper again, can I enter? And gatekeeper says that yes, the room is empty, you go ahead. And that's how we said that the bounded waiting was not guaranteed in my analogy. That's how we have to check. First we have to put a process in critical section first. So let me first bring the process P1, it loads the value 0, it compares with 1, comparison is false. It will not jump to statement 1, that is 34 instruction. It will come below, it will change the value of lock to 1 and it will enter into critical section. Now while it is doing the execution in critical section, bring the process P2 now. It will load the value 1 in its register. The comparison will become true and it will jump to statement 77. That is the first statement here, isn't it? And that's how this loop is going to execute again and again, again and again till this comparison remains true. So here again this will load the value 1 only because this lock variable value is 1. So it will load the value 1, it will compare again with 1, the comparison will be true and it will again jump. Isn't it? So that's how the one process I have made in the waiting state in the entry section now. Now let us ask the question to the process P1. Here is the important point. Now let us ask the question to the P1. If you come out of the critical section now, are you able to enter in critical section again? This question we have to ask. So let me proceed with process P1 now. Let it come out of critical section. The moment it comes out of critical section, the value of lock will be set to 0 one more time. One more important point is, at this moment I am not executing process P2. I am just concentrating on process P1. Process P1 is only scheduled to CPU. Okay, so assuming that P1 is only under execution, lock is equal to 0, it will change the value and let's ask the question one more time. Are you able to enter in CS again? So let me execute the process P1's entry section one more time. Okay, so what value it will load in register? 0. Come below, compare 0 equal to equal to 1, comparison is false. So that's why the next statement will not jump and the program counter will come below and it will change the value of lock to 1 and enter into critical section. If I schedule the process P2, it will what value it will load in register? It will simply load the value 1 because it has again made the value of lock to 1. So that's why this is going to read the value of lock as 1 and 1 is equal to 1, again the comparison is true, again it will loop. So that's how the bounded waiting is not guaranteed. So out of these 3 requirements, only one requirement is guaranteed, which is progress. So is the lock variable mechanism a good mechanism? No, it is not. Definitely it is not, because the basic condition, which is mutual exclusion, is not guaranteed by this. Let me just simplify the code we have written. P1 and P2. So instead of, you know, duplicating the code in entry section, in both the processes, if I have n processes, I have to repeat this code in every process, every program out of n processes, right? So instead of that, what I'll do, I will define some function, common function, at which I will write the logic of entry section. So my function name is entry section, and I will call this entry section function from the entry section of the process, means just above the critical section code, I will call this function. And similarly, exit section function is common for both the process P1 and P2. I just call this function here. The logic is same. I am just simplifying the arrangement of this entry section and exit section code, so I don't have to write the code again and again. So there will be no redundancy of code, though you can call it from any program. And that's how we reach to the end of this topic. The first synchronization mechanism, that is lock variable, which is not a good solution, by the way. In the next session, we are going to discuss the second synchronization mechanism, which is strict alternation. So thank you for watching this video. I hope that was useful. Feel free to send me any queries or comment below. See you in the next session.